Start. So my name is Filipe, and I'm here presenting at ApacheCon Home on an observability track on my opinion why averages lie and how to truly monitor your systems. Giving you a little bit of context of who am I. So I'm Portuguese. I'm a performance engineer at Redis Labs. I work mainly towards improving and developing open source or open source tools, and also developing as a consequence observability tools, performance tools, to be able to properly identify what are the bottlenecks and act upon, etc. So the overall idea is that we use these types of tools, and we use the what we have available to be able to improve the products that you develop. Going through the agenda. So today, I'll start by the takeaway. I'll start by the single sentence that I wanted you guys to be opinionated about. Then we'll deep dive on trying to understand different patterns or different latency behaviors of your application, the problems that come with it, how to solve it, and then presenting some numbers around some different data structures that allow us to have a full understanding of the latency behavior on our systems. The key takeaway is basically this sentence. A single number is not enough to fully describe the latency of your system, to have a full visibility of how your system is behaving with regards to latency. I'll justify why is latency so important, but prior than that, let's take a quick step back and try to think about why do we write code. This is not a philosophical question. The overall idea around me making this question is to identify that we normally write code to respond to someone's needs. So basically, either a business need, or organizational needs, society, anyone wants to have some work done. So, and as soon as we identify the work that we care about, we need to be able to measure how performant are we on the task that we set ourselves to do. And this is the work around performance engineering, is to try to measure the amount of useful work that I'm doing out of the overall work that's required on my application, on the system that I'm developing. And to do so, we basically need metrics, metrics that are deterministic, that help us to fully characterize the system that we are developing upon and developing or analyzing. Removing some of the abstraction and giving some example, imagine that you have an application and you want to understand its behavior. You can focus the performance engineering around several metrics. Some of them like operations per unit of time, like requests per second, success metrics, error metrics, etc. And one very, very important one that mostly all engineers working around it focus upon is latency. And why latency when compared to others? Or why is this metric so important when compared to the other ones that we can use to understand our system? And the simple answer is that latency provides us the user's perspective. Whereas, for example, the number of requests per second, the system load, will only give me insight of the system that I'm using to serve some client, to serve or the purpose that I set myself to. Latency will provide you the perspective of the person that's using it, the application that's using it, etc. So we will basically have the look and feel of the persons or the users that are depending upon your application. And to be able to, first, to be able to understand latency, we will simply define it. Latency is basically the length of the operation, whether we are talking about some request to a database, request to an HTTP server. The latency is basically the length of from the start up until the end of the operation. And to be able to understand it, or to be able to start understanding and analyzing latency behaviors, latency distributions, we need to keep track of it. And to keep track of it, the naive approach would be to basically just store all data. If I have all data stored, I'll be able to completely analyze the latency behavior. But the problem is that it's very expensive, it's unfeasible, we don't have infinite amount of compute time, we don't have infinite amount of storage, etc. So this is this would be the ideal approach, to be able to have all data always ready to be queried, but this is unfeasible. So then we move to a common case approach. So we try to solve this with a common case number, basically by calculating the average of all the samples of all the latency samples that I've recorded. But the problem is that basically the average is high, and they try and they hide the problem. And I'm going to give you some examples of some patterns, latency patterns, that you should identify yourself with. So let's start with the good, a bad, and the ugly averages. The good average is basically an average that follows the normal distribution. So if this was the pattern that we would be seeing, that we would see if we plotted the latency distribution, everything would be perfect. We would be able to fully describe our system latency behavior by just having a mean, a standard deviation, given that the mean is symmetric, or the latency distribution is symmetric about the mean. The issue is that this is not what happens on real life scenarios on distributed systems. Normally, when you plot the latencies of your system, you would have something like this, a long-tailed latency distribution. And the issue around this is that basically we are completely disregarding the higher latency values. We are only focusing ourselves on the good part of the latency distribution. And the problem is that this can get a lot worse. As an example, you can, instead of just seeing a long tail distribution, you can start seeing multimodal distributions. And this is normally due to having multiple workflows, multiple patterns on the same application. For example, you have a read path and a write path, and the reads are a lot faster than the writes. And you basically will start having multimodal, three-model distributions. And this can even get worse. So you can have an average that's it's not representing any user experience within our application. For example, if I have really fast reads and slow writes, I can have a calculated average that basically sits in the middle of both latency distributions, and I'm basically trying to analyze my system based on a metric that no one, or based on a latency that no one is experiencing. And to give you an insight, or to try to justify how common this is, and how this is not related to my application maturity, to my company maturity, these two charts basically represents, or basically plot the latency distribution of 50 random production servers from Netflix around an HTTP server and a data store. And as you can see, a company that we are used to relate towards so many good work around latency, or around performance engineering, you can see that this is not bound to the capacity of your engineers, the capacity of your product, etc. This will happen on any application. So basically, we need to be ready to be able to analyze these types of latency distributions, and not base ourselves around an average that basically lies and is susceptible to outliers. As we've seen before, it's completely hiding the long tail. It's underestimating, or even not estimating any of the actual user experience. And we know that by basically having better understanding, we can take better decisions. This is this can be applied in anything in our life. So basically, to be able to solve it, we need a better metric. We should not rely just upon the average. So we need a metric that's basically representative of data, it's patient time efficient, because if we didn't have these constraints, basically just storing all data and querying all data would be enough, and it's practical to use. And for that, we have percentiles. So the percentiles will basically give you a value of up to a point of the distribution in which a percentage of those observations lie below. Giving you a quick example, the percentile 90 of a group of observation of latencies would give you the number at which 90% of our users at the most will experience that latency. But to give more concrete examples, doing a quick bullet points around questions and the way to answer them, what's the latency that 90% of our user experience, as I've told before, is the percentile 90. What, for example, is our worst 1% latency interval that can be basically answered by plotting the percentile distribution between the P99 and the P100. And can we compare them? Can we compare the latency distribution of this week with last week? We can completely do it by just plotting both intervals and do a differentiation. And something that comes for free when we start having the data structures to be able to compare or to be able to compute percentiles is that we are also able to compute the inverse function that's basically enables us to answer to questions like, for example, what's the percentage of users that are served up to a certain point? For example, 1 millisecond, 5 milliseconds. Regarding space and time efficiency, we are somewhere in the middle between having an average, having the full latency values. So basically we now are moving from having millions of samples to having dozens and hundreds of samples, depending on the data structure that we are using to calculate the percentiles and the cumulative distributed functions. Regarding being practical to use and being useful across several maturities of your company or your project, basically you can start by looking, if you're a small company, if you're a startup, you can start by looking at the initial percentiles of the percentile distribution. So for example, I created now a startup. I'm not going to focus my efforts around improving the P99 or the P39s, because I have more important stuff. More low-hanging fruit laying around. Like I want to improve first the 50% of my user latency requests, and then when I mature myself, when I'm in a big company, like for example Twitter, you will not be able to focus on the percentile 50. You should be focusing on the higher end latencies or the higher end percentiles, because those are the ones that matter the most. 1% of 1% of bad latency experiences for Twitter is a lot worse than 1% of bad latency experiences for a small company or a company that is starting. So basically, you can adjust the interval range that you are focusing yourself upon depending on the maturity of your project, company age, etc. And to be able to help us understand why this is so important and so easy to use, we'll basically plot the latency percentile distribution, in which basically on the x-axis you have the full percentile range, on the y-axis you have the latency values. So just to give a quick context on how does this relate, or how does this compare against the average. So these are real numbers, real samples collected from my local machine. If I based my analysis upon a mean, I would be basing myself or looking at 1.5 milliseconds. And I will be completely disregarding everything else up to the right. So everything else up to 17 milliseconds, or 10 times worse latencies than the mean is providing me. So I will be basically focusing myself on the good part of the latency distributions and completely disregarding the bad part and the part that I should improve upon. Regarding answering the exact same questions that we've seen before, what's the latency that 90% of our users experience? We will basically just look at the plot, look at the x-axis on the 90% of 90, and basically retrieve the latency value that was observed. The same thing happens when we're talking about intervals. We focus ourselves upon the interval distribution of the percentile range that we want to look at. So the worst 1% latency would be between P99 and P100. and to be able to compare ourselves against different observations or different periods of time, we will basically just plot them together and understand if we were worse or not, and where did we got worse, or what's the range of percentiles in which we got worse. Regarding what's the inverse of the percentile, the cumulative distributed function, instead of looking through the x-axis, we would then look to the y-axis and trying to find the or calculate the CDF of 1 millisecond and 5 milliseconds, and that would basically enable us to answer questions like what's the percentage of users that are served up to 1 millisecond, and in this example it would be 5%, and the CDF of 5, or what's the percentage of users that were served up to 5 milliseconds, would be 99.8% of users. With an average, you don't have, it's impossible to have this type of correlation. So you don't have any relation with the amount of users or amount of data points that are within a certain range. But now that we know that we can calculate percentiles, or that we need percentiles and CDFs, we need to have a data structure to be able to do so, or to be able to compute it. And for that, we have histograms. They come in different flavors. You have T-digest, the iDynamic range histogram, D-digest. We have a lot of different sketches or data structures that will allow you to have the full latency distribution. But you should not focus upon a specific implementation. You should first ask the right questions. How does this implementation will provide, or what's the precision that this implementation will provide me? How space efficient it is? How speed efficient it is? Does it allow grouping of several collections, several histograms? These are the right questions that should be asked prior than choosing an implementation. And for this, specifically for this talk, and I think that on a real world scenario or on latency observation, I think that if you choose either the T-digest or the HDR histogram, I've added the links here for you to follow because they have different implementations, different ports on several languages. So you should be able to be served by using either T-digest or the HDR histogram. And I chose them too because they have a very interesting property in which they differ. So basically, on precision, the iDynamic range histogram is more precise on the start of an interval. So if you apply this towards latency observations, I would say that I'm more interested upon the latencies that are smaller. So for example, if I have an application, I'm very, very interested on having high precision on values up to 1 millisecond, up to 1 second. And then I really don't care, as soon as you start moving away from the interval start, I don't care if I have a percentage of error that's not as relevant as the initial interval starts. So I don't care if I have a 1 millisecond error rate on a 1 minute sample. That's the overall idea around the iDynamic range interval is that you have better accuracy and the interval start. Regarding the T-digest, you are not bound, the accuracy is not really bound at an interval range, is more bound how does that sample matches towards the full data points that I have on my histogram. So basically, this histogram is more accurate on low percentiles and high percentiles, and reduces accuracy when you are, for example, at the middle of the observations that you have. So basically, you have more precision when you need it. So low percentiles, that's basically the percentile 001 or the P49s, you have a high precision there, and you lose precision on the P50 or P55, etc. Regarding space efficiency, typically on a typical usage of the iDynamic range histogram, you will need around 31K to have a full range of observations of 1 day with microsecond precision. Around the T-digest, you should also have you should expect an overall space uses around 20 kilobytes. So, but it's important to state that this is more specifically on the iDynamic range histogram. This is very, very bound towards your interval range, towards the precision that you want. So these values should be taken just as a reference. You should deep dive on each of the implementations to try to understand what would be the memory footprints that you would account for when using either of the histograms. Regarding speed, so on the speed question or the speed group, I try to focus myself on the real-time ops. So basically, I try to benchmark both writes and reads. And around writes, the iDynamic range histogram is really, really fast. You can basically insert or ingest data points at a nanosecond, costing a nanosecond, 5 nanoseconds per data point. Regarding the digest, it's more expensive on insertions, so it's up to 10 to 12 times more expensive than the iDynamic range histogram on writes, but it wins on reads, basically. But this is also very dependent upon the configuration or upon the settings that you've defined your histograms when creating them or when initializing them. But the overall idea is that this should be taken as a reference, and you should understand that these histograms are very fast and are really suited for real-time computation, both the reads and the writes on quantile computation. And also, even merging, you can merge histograms. So basically, join the value observations of one histogram with another histogram at a microsecond level. Regarding grouping or merging, as I spoken, they both support it. And this is very important because you can basically have several histograms with different granularities and merge them to be able to have a full latency distribution of your system. So you can have, for example, several histograms, one per machine or one per time range, etc. And then you can merge it. This is very, very important. There are several histograms implementation that don't support it. So you should take this into account. Regarding the key differences between these two histograms, as I've spoken before, basically the bin boundaries or the precision, the amount of bins that you have or that will accommodate samples, are for the HDR histogram are dependent on the interval range. For the T-digest, are dependent on the data set. So depending on the data set, you will have more or less bins. Regarding what lies ahead, so when up to this point, we know that averages lie, and we have a better way of having full latency distribution of your system or a full latency analysis of your system. But there's still a lot of work to do in the matters of applying this knowledge, applying these data structures to our everyday life. So even up today, we are basing ourselves on the observability tools, on the time series databases, on a common case scenario, and we should make efforts towards having a full visibility over time. So basically, we should focus upon applying the data structures that we have now, that are extremely fast, that are purposely built for real-time computation. So now it's just a matter of applying them towards the projects that we work on our daily basis. So basically, and as a quick side note, just having a full latency behavior and distribution analysis is not enough. So basically, as soon as you start unlocking this type of visibility, you will want more and you will need more. So basically, after you have this, you need to start calculating this metric or with more metrics of your system to have a full picture of what's going on. So relying on a single metric is not enough. We saw that relying on a single number is not enough. We now are moving to having more numbers per metric, but then we need to rely on several metrics to have full visibility. Regarding what's more, I really wanted to kick off the discussion around how are you guys computing or doing latency analysis on your system. And I've prepared bullets around the references or around the things that you should look at when investigating this matter. And apart from that, I will now leave the remaining time for the discussion. And hopefully we have questions to answer. If you guys share on the chat, I'll be willingly answer all your questions. Or if I don't have the straight answer, at least point you towards reference things, basically. If we don't have questions, I want to thank everybody for listening to me, and let's chat on Twitter. Let's basically make this happen. Let's have more visibility on the applications that we work upon, because now we have all means to do so. And thank you.